Okay. First of all, thanks to the organizers, Mirta, Michael, and Jeremy for organizing, also for inviting me to take part in this fascinating workshop. I thoroughly enjoyed those last 2 days already. So this talk is concerned with the role of individual and collective memory in the human cultural adaptation process. In particular, we're going to ask, how do human groups adapt culturally to temporarily changing environments? Now, of course, this question has already sparked an enormous amount of theoretical and empirical cultural evolutionary research, leading to an actually quite simple answer, namely through a combination of innovation and social learning. I don't even attempt here to try to find innovation, but in this literature, it's often seen as a trial or similar to trial and error experimentation. Importantly, the process of innovation leads to the introduction of novel variants, but possesses intrinsic uncertainties about the adaptiveness or cost of these novel variants. In contrast, social learning is defined as learning through observations of or interactions with other individuals or its products. Social learning facilitates the spread of often adaptive cultural variants through the population, but bears the danger of transmitting outdated information, especially after an environmental change. So on the one hand, we have a process which generates novelty, potentially at varying quality, and on the other, a process that helps some of those cultural variants to spread, and therefore the population to be well adapted to current environmental conditions. So, and depending on the stability or instability of the environment, so how frequently it changes, this balance between these two processes has to be very finely tuned. And it is one of the classic results of the cultural evolutionary literature that the usefulness of social learning decreases when with increasing environmental instabilities. And of course, the opposite is true for innovation. And the precise shape of this relationship depends on the specifics of the model used to derive. But let's stay with this relationship for just a second, and let's look at these stable periods. So here we expect that propensities for social learning have evolved to relatively high levels, and the propensity for innovation to relatively low levels. That also means that we expect the cultural diversity to be relatively low, as social learning is likely to have established just a very few highly adapted variants in the population already, leading to high levels of adaptation in stable periods. But when the environmental change happens, then of course it is likely that there is no cultural variant in the population that provides now an adaptive benefit, and so the adaptation level goes down to zero and the population has to wait until an adaptive variant has been invented. So, of course, the length of this waiting time depends crucially on the complexity of the environment. But once such an variant has been invented, social learning can help spreading it, leading to an increase in the adaptation level and further more adapted innovations, then lead to the population having a very well adapted state where the need for further innovations is relatively low. So of course, such a scenario is already very well known in the genetic literature, and there often it's called adaptation through de novo innovation. But I would like to stress here that there are very good reasons to believe that the cultural innovation process doesn't proceed with the same random fashion as a genetic one. So there's a huge amount of work to be done in understanding what are the differences between adaptation through de novo innovation in the genetic and the cultural setting, but well, it's quite a topic of a different talk. So now let's look at this unstable period. Now we have expected the propensity for social learning to have evolved to a low level, and consequently the propensity for innovation to a high level. And that also means we expect cultural diversity to be high, leading to relatively low levels of adaptation during stable periods. But when now an environmental change happens, then of course it is likely that the population already maintains a cultural variant which is now adapted to these changed environmental conditions. Social learning can now act immediately to help spreading this variant or these variants, leading to a very fast adaptation process, where importantly the adaptation level doesn't drop down to zero as we have seen before. And of course, also this scenario is already very, very well known in genetics, and they are often called adaptations through standing variation. Now, I just would like to repeat, because it's central to our argument, adaptations through standing variation often leads to lower adaptation of unstable periods, as this variation has to be expressed. And precisely this point, that it's usually assumed that all variants are expressed, has led us to our research question. because in contrast to the genetic system, our cognition allows for very sophisticated memory processes, truly speaking, the recall of past experiences. So in our case, we could imagine that there is a possibility of remembering cultural variants we have used in the past alongside the adaptation levels they provided in those experiment environments. So in the following, we're going to ask, can memory, as broadly defined as recall of past experiences, contribute to the efficiency of the cultural adaptation process? And this is work done in collaboration with Madeleine Amar, as a PhD student in my group, and Laura Fogarty. And I really want to stress that Madeleine is a driving force of this project. Okay, so we try to answer this question by developing a simulation framework, including memory, social learning, innovation, and environmental instability. And then we're going to use this model to explore the evolution of social learning under memory in periodically changing environment. As per definition, memory is of very little use for adaptation when the environment has not been seen before. Okay, let me very briefly describe the model to you. It consists of three main components: environment, cultural variant, individuals. For sake of simplification, we assume here that the environment can only have two states. However, I stress that the cultural dynamic, or that the dynamics play out very similarly if you assume a K environmental situation. So in each time that step, the environment can change with a certain probability. And now our cultural variants, they're assumed to be adapted to a single environmental state only, and there they possess an adaptation value, which can vary between 0 and 1. And now our individuals are allowed to have a cultural memory. And this cultural memory can be comprised of their individual knowledge about the number of cultural variants and the adaptation level those variants have been provided in the environmental states that have been experienced in the past. Further, our individuals are characterized by their propensity to engage in social learning and their propensity to forget. I will explain in a second what we mean by this forgetting part. So now in each time step, we assume that our individuals can somewhat accurately infer in which environmental state they are, and then they have to go through a couple of steps. First, they have to choose which cultural variants to express or to use in order to get the adaptation level in this time step. To do this, they first have to evaluate the memory. So they go through all the variants in the memory and choose a variant proportional to the adaptation level, to the stored adaptation level in this environment. So, and then in the next step, they have to decide whether this variant is already good enough or whether they wish to engage in learning. And they engage in learning for a probability of 1 minus the adaptation level of the variant chosen from the memory. And this assumption kind of is rooted in the fact that there's only a very strong need for learning if the variant that has been chosen is not already well adapted. So if our individuals decide to learn, then they engage in social learning with probability C and an innovation with a probability 1 minus C. Social learning happens in a pair of biased manner, and innovation simply means the introduction of a variant and the adaptation level is the introduction of a novel variant, where the adaptation level is simply randomly drawn from the interval 0 and 1. Now, this learned or innovated variant is expressed, and the individual adds this variant to its memory if it's not already maintained. So if our individual does not choose to learn, then it just simply expresses the variant chosen from the memory. And importantly, we record how many times each variant is chosen by each individual. So, and lastly, we allow our individuals to forget. So meaning individuals may not retain the whole knowledge forever. So, and forgetting happens with this inherited probability phi. And if forgetting happens, then the individual loses 1 variant contained in its memory. And the variant to be forgotten is chosen inversely proportional to the number of times it has been expressed. Okay. Demographic dynamics are very similar to that of a Moran model. So we choose 1 individual for death and 1 for reproduction. Implying a constant population size for our study, we will choose this population size to 200. So death occurs at random and reproduction occurs proportional to the adaptation level of the expressed variant in the last time step. Now, the reproducing individual passes on its C and phi values, so propensity for social learning, propensity for forgetting, largely faithfully, but of course, with small probabilities, mutations can occur. And importantly, our individual passes on its memory to the offspring, but importantly, the count, the usage count of those vertically transmitted cultural variant in the offspring, they're set to one. So that's a very conservative assumption, as in theory, so one vertically transmitted trait can be forgotten just after one or two time steps. Okay, now repeating those model steps sufficiently many times, that allows us to study the joint evolution of the propensity for social learning, the propensity for forgetting, and the structure of the individual and population level memory for different levels of environmental instability. But before we do this, let's look at two slightly simpler cases first. First, we assume that the propensity for forgetting is zero for all individuals, meaning we don't allow our individuals to build up a memory. So, and reassuringly, this no memory situation recreates our classical social learning results. So in this middle figure here, we see the average propensity for social learning in the population with respect to environmental instability, which is the probability that the environment is changing in every time step, so shown on this on the x-axis. We stop at 0.2 because that already implies 40 changes per generation in our study system. So what we see is this propensity is nicely decreasing with environmental instability, and the same is also true for the adaptation. So let's have a very quick look at the time course of those adaptation levels of a single simulation for a stable and an unstable environment. And not surprisingly, those two figures resemble the sketches I have shown you before, characterizing adaptations through de novo innovation and adaptations through standing innovation. I just want to mention that in our situation, we make it our individual super easy to invent an adaptive variant. So the waiting time is incredibly short in this example. Okay, let's assume the opposite. Let's assume that the propensity for forgetting is one, meaning that we have a full memory. Our individuals are allowed to remember everything. And this full memory situation is actually quite interesting because it leads to lower level of adaptation for low to intermediate levels of environmental stability compared to the no memory situation. Well, if an individual remembers every invented or learned variant, then it accumulates a large repertoire of variant, potentially of very varying adaptation levels. And now choosing those from this memory will, with not a small probability, lead to the choice of this quite suboptimal variant because our choice is proportional to the adaptation. So keeping everything is really not the best idea for those small and intermediate environmental instabilities, but for high environment stabilities, of course, our full memory situation does much better than the no memory situation. And well, simply, if we have filled up our memory, then almost every variant will have well-adapted variant of the other environment in their memory. So, adaptation can happen relatively quickly. And we also see that, well, there's almost no dependence on environmental stability. And again, this makes sense because, again, once a memory it has filled up, it doesn't matter how often this environment is changing. The individuals kind of act in the same way. I would not put too much emphasis on these evolved social learning propensities simply because we kept the memory capacity of an individual to 1,000, meaning that after this memory has been filled up, those social learning propensities showed a more or less like drift-like behavior. Briefly looking at our time courses of the adaptation level, confirm all our conclusion, we see almost no difference between a stable and an unstable environment. So this full memory may shield you against the drop in an adaptation level at an environmental change, but they don't allow for high adaptation level in stable periods. So now let's finally let the forgetting propensity evolve alongside our social learning propensity. And now though the results are shown by those yellow lines here, now excitingly, we have a situation where the adaptation level stays high for all environmental instabilities. And this is generated by these propensities for social learning and for forgetting. So let's look at social learning first. We see that For all instabilities, our social learning propensity is relatively high, apart from, let's say, the situation where our environment doesn't change at all. And this also can be explained because that's due to the impact of vertical social learning. Because if my environment is stable, over time, the population will have invented and spread variants close to the optimal. And those variants are also transmitted vertically, kind of removing the need for further learning. So in some sense, we remove all the selection pressure in the system at this point, and our social learning propensity behaves more drift-like. But if there's any uncertainty in the environment, we see that social learning propensities are supposed to be high, at least in connection with this propensity for forgetting. So before we go on and explore what kind of memories these forgetting propensities generate, let's have a last look at those time courses of the adaptation level. And we see that now the adaptation level stays high for stable periods. And well, we see a very rapid adaptation process happening. And that's a nice thing. It happens the same in both stability scenarios. Okay, so what's this forgetting rate doing? Well, in some sense, we see that the forgetting rate is decreasing for increasing environmental stability, which naturally means that for more unstable environments, we should have a larger memory. And that's also what we see. However, it is notable that those memories are not that large. In a highly unstable environment, we still have an average only 10 variants in our memory. Also, I want to stress that there's quite some considerable amount of individual level variation here. So, and that's interesting because in some sense, these memories are perfect for shielding us against two dangers. The first danger is, of course, if my memory is too large, well, then I have the problem of, you know, occasionally choosing a suboptimal variant from this memory. But also if my memory is too low or too small, then I have the problem of, accidental forgetting of adaptive variants. And those these memory sizes, they seem to kind of nicely balance these kind of different influence factors. So individual memories stay relatively small, but the exciting question is now, do those individual memories actually contain information about the other environment? So in order to figure that one out, we calculated the probability that the population as a whole has at least one variant that is adapted to the other environment. So, and that's what's shown here with this blue line. If we have a very stable environment, meaning we have only on average change every 50 generation, then still in 10% of the changes, the population has at least one variant which is adapted to the other environment. So when my environment becomes a little bit more unstable than as predicted, this probability goes down. And then we are here, which is roughly one change every 10 generation, we are almost at zero. Meaning, you know, on the population level, we have a variant in it that is adapted to this other environment. And the even more exciting fact is that, well, for those small levels of environmental instability, it's not that every individual has this variant. It's actually only a very, very small number of individuals which contains those variants adaptive to this other environment. So what we have is actually a collective memory where only a small number of individuals have information or an adaptive variant in this other environment. Once environmental change is happening, they can express it. And our high social learning rate is then able to spread those variants very effectively through the population, leading us to this situation where we have this high adaptation level in almost all environmental conditions. So let me quickly summarize. The cognitive capacity for memory can provide an efficient, effective way of keeping information useful in another environmental context in the population without, well, strongly affecting the population's adaptation level. But the memory needs to be shaped in a particular way. Simply remember, everything's not sufficient. And a collective memory, meaning only a few people that have this adaptive information in the other environment, in combination with these high propensities for social learning, lead to these high levels of adaptation in all caveat periodically changing environment. So in some sense, that's also seems to be to solve a Rogers paradox. And also, I would like to mention that this vertical social learning has an absolutely important role to play in this game, because this vertical social learning is the only way in which unexpressed variants can be transmitted between generations. So without vertical transmission, this whole memory of the knowledge contained in the memory stays within a generation, and then it's kind of lost. So vertical transmission is key to this process. And I'm the first to admit that all those results, what we got so far, are derived from a model with, you know, as easy as possible assumptions. And we're working in the future, and we work already on ways on how we can generalize those assumptions. So for instance, we're really keen on looking at more challenging environments, or on allowing our cultural variants to have specialist or generalist features. So especially a specialist variant in our framework could be a variant which is adapted to a very narrow range of environmental conditions, but has a very high p-value of adaptation. A more generalist variant is adapted to a wider range of environmental conditions, but has a much, much lower peak adaptation level. So, and what very, very preliminary results seem to show is that the evolving memories, they seem to be largely consisting of those generalist variants. Further, we are interested in introducing kind of a production element to it, meaning that there's a difference whether we express or use a variant the first time or the 50th time. But most excitingly, we are interested in the question of how this vertically transmitted memory or vertically transmitted unexpressed variants actually degrade in their usefulness. So kind of the fact, if you don't use something, if you have never seen it being used, and it's still, just transmitted from generation to generation, you of course expect its degradation of use over time. So that at some point after enough generation has been passed, where these unexpressed variants have been, passed on, they actually don't contain any information about these past environmental conditions anymore. So we are asking, what is the faithfulness that we need in this transmission process for it to work. But also, if you have some information, we can ask, if vertical transmission is not strong enough to kind of retain in this information for long enough in the population, what else do we need to involve if we want to keep this information in this in our population? So do we need to involve social institution? Do we need to generate cultural artifacts? Or do we need to generate narratives to transmit this information? But that's all future work, and hopefully we will answer some of that. And the last minute of this talk, I will devote to an absolutely wild speculation. So the organizers basically asked me whether I could make a speculation on how these collective memory ideas could be applied to problems of collective behavior. And I incredibly grateful that they asked me, because together with Adam Powell, we were thinking about ways on how we can apply this collective memory idea to collective surges on rugged landscapes. So our idea here is that, social learning, or often it's used that what we socially learn is good things. It's kind of variants that has a high adaptation level. But what we propose is that, maybe social learning can also help to generate a collective map of our landscape. From our experiences, we create a map which we update basically as we generate new experiences. And we can base social, probably not in virtual learning, it's probably a mistake on the slide, based on this collective map. So at the bare minimum, such a collective map, which also could be very different for each individual if we were allowing for network structures and different sharing mechanisms of those, or different sharing of those in a social information between individuals. But this collective map could potentially at least avoid the doubling of exploration effort, because at least it tells you, okay, this is a bad area, we don't need to try this, we have tried this already, rest your attention to something else. So in some sense, what we want to explore is whether information of something that didn't work actually might help greatly in this adaptation process, or in finding the optimal or finding a good solution to a very complex problem. But again, that's totally wild speculation, but Adam and I are quite excited to at least see whether it holds some water. Okay, lastly, I would again thank my wonderful collaborators and thank you for listening, and look forward to your questions now.
Thank you very much. Great talk. I would like to invite, we have maybe 10 minutes for questions. Sarah, would you like to start?
Hi, Anne. Thanks for that great talk. So I was wondering, it seems like the invention of writing systems should basically greatly expand the kind of collective memory a population should have. So do you see any kind of, or are there any historical contexts in which you can kind of examine whether, certain aspects of the predictions of this extended collective memory can holds up?
I think, with the advent of writing, probably the dynamic changes. Because that's, precisely where you can record things and you can store something safely, and you don't, you kind of remove the need for transmitting it almost vertically. And you kind of, you have then a medium which can transmit it relatively faithfully from one generation to another. So, and I think that, of course, provides or keeps this this memory so much better in the population. And I think what this model gets at is kind of, the pre-writing step, the step before, where we maybe cannot record this information with this, reliability, and also we cannot transmit it that reliably between generations. But I mean, we exactly be looking for situations where, things have evolved, like dedicated persons who know every medical treatment in the population. And, this knowledge is very tightly conserved in this population, even so, certain treatments to certain illnesses are not necessary in this, or has not happened in this period, but nevertheless they have existed. So I know of evidence about this, that the knowledge about illnesses planned precedes what has happened in this generation, and also that this transmission happens highly in a specialized manner, that there's always one or two dedicated person and they pass it on incredibly faithfully to the next person. And that's a situation where people probably assume that, okay, that's something very important what we need to keep. However, just letting random people transmitting random things in the population is probably not faithful enough to actually keep it in the population at the quality that we need. And so we need this, whatever you call it, social institution, and which ensures this faithful transmission. So I think that's this kind of very interesting relationship between the within generation transmission, but also with the within generation learning that happens. But with the advent of writing, I think, you have a way of keeping those memory so much better, in the population.
Thank you. Paul, would you like to go next?
Thanks. Thanks, Anna. That was a really, really interesting talk. Sorry, I got slightly distracted. I heard my child screaming in the background, but it's okay. I have so many questions that it's hard to pick one, but I'll stick with something that's relatively maybe simple. I'm wondering, sort of to what extent do these results hold over greater environmental variability on sort of two regards, right? One is just more variation in the potential environments, that it's so things that were, adaptive in the past may not come back to be adaptive. And two, which direction to go? Let's go with, the extent to which information flow, especially because you're talking about collective search on rugged landscapes, right? When things are in memory, this gives the opportunity for recombination and innovation in new ways. And that potentially changes the direction, the trajectory of the population's adaptiveness in sort of new and exciting ways that, that can't be captured by this kind of model, which is fine. But I'm wondering what, you know, what you think about how this, these kinds of questions maybe affect the findings.
The one point, again, which I hopefully made very clear, is that all those findings hold in periodically changing environments. So what we are trying to do currently, that only answers part of your question, but let me see whether we get to you, having this periodically changing environments, but with some probability we change to an environment which we'll never see again. So, and this is an also an interesting, test, hopefully, how high we can notch this, this new environment before, the social learning has to go down again. Because again, then we play off like, okay, and when we have these new environments coming in where we have nothing before, then we need innovations. I mean, now social learning is not, it's super crazily high. It is at roughly 83%. So the question is the 30% enough? And whether this is enough probably depends on the quality of the or the complexity of the environment. In our current environment, it is. But again, we make it our individuals so incredibly easy to innovate something good that it's, that's not surprising. So what we need to do is to find ways to make our environment way more complex and do the whole thing again and see what happens to this process when innovation is not that easy. On the one hand, I would see that the importance of memory is more pronounced, but I also see the danger if you go to an environment which we have not seen before, then memory is useless and we need good innovation. So this is another trade-off which we hopefully will address in the future, but you're absolutely right. And again, the model holds only in the very specified situation which I've described. And now I forgot your second question. It was recombination. Sorry. Yes. I would love to, because that's precisely where we need to go. But in order to do this, we need to have a model which doesn't treat traits as A, B, C, and D, and E, which treats model as evolving. It's on the list. Not done yet, but it's precisely where we want to go. But unfortunately, we don't have the tools for it yet. But it's on the list, and hopefully, in a year, maybe two, we can make some predictions about this. Sorry to be not more precise.
That's great.
Great, it's Jeremy.
Thanks. Awesome talk, Anna. So I might have missed it. Is there like a specific mechanistic connection between the social learning trait and vertical transmission? So I imagine in some ways these things have to be kind of mechanistically intertwined to some degree. Your ability to sort of learn from other individuals has to be connected.
They are, first of all, who is allowed to transmit vertically? That depends on the trait you're having. Because that's how you choose who's allowed to reproduce, and how social learning works is, well, we use it in a kind of payoff biased way, that you sample the population or the part of the population you're connected to, and then you choose proportional to whatever trait they have expressed. So in some sense, yes, they are intertwined in a very right. weird way, that what happens within the generation kind of determines who gets to pass something on to the next generation. So, and that's, I think, how the link between the two is. But again, in my model, or in our model, the vertical transmission is the only way on how we can get right. unexpressed variants across. So leaving it out will reduce to no memory model almost.
And sure. So I guess I was wondering if there was sort of, if those, that sort of evolvability of social learning was mechanistically tied to some level of vertical transmission that presumably the same kinds of cognitive traits that allow them to socially learn? Are,
yeah, like, so I think very loosely. I think what it does is, you know, it can take away selection pressure towards evolving high rates of social learning, because actually it can do some of the work of social learning, because it can spread effectively those good variants through the population already by vertical transmission. So basically it can remove the need, but it removes the need, or this only is true for incredibly incredibly stable environments. So for later on, I would say both have you know, quite some important roles to play. And also I want to say that the vertical transmission, the way it's presented it here, is, well, incredibly crude, because it's actually a very weak process. We have also now tried to say, like, okay, vertical transmission means, you know, transmission from parent to offspring. And often, you know, parents put in some more effort in teaching their children than they would do random people. So what we assumed is that we don't transmit the whole memory, but we only select the best trait what the parent has in both environments. And if we do this, that improves even more the adaptation level. But interestingly, the social learning rate is almost unchanged. Huh. It doesn't affect it dramatically. I think it goes tiny, I can show you the figure yeah. later. I think it goes a tiny little bit down, but it's not a huge, or not a strong impact.
Very cool.
And to tell you the last question.
Thanks. Hi, Anne. Fantastic talk, as usual. I had a question about the environments, the different environments that you have. So periodically, I guess, so that you're switching between two environments. And do they have the same duration then? Because, I mean, how does that correlate with the rates of forgetting and the rates of...
Or the environment, the population spends on average the same amount in each environment. Because basically, mm-hmm. what we have is a probability parameter who controls the switching. Going back and forth.
Okay.
Sorry. Okay. Now I'm talking rubbish. Of course, in a small period of time, of course there is some problem that from the beginning of the recording, you know, wherever you are there, you're quite likely to stay in this environment. Mm-hmm. However, we run our simulations relatively long. And what we record is basically, or how we calculate these population level propensities is basically burn in, and then another, thousand generations. And then at one time point, we record basically those levels in the population. And that we do this many times, and that basically should result in a situation where, you know, a change has just happened. A change has happened very long time ago. So in some sense, we hope that we kind of, this is already captured in our, in the stochasticity of the results.